Thank you. morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome again to the house of the Lord. Every time I stand here each week, I'm just struck at how blessed we are. What a privilege to be in the house of God. So many places we could be in our life. But God has graced us for this opportunity to be here with one another and to gather in his presence, to be with Jesus. It's such a wonderful thing. As part of our celebration today, following our 10:45 service, we will have a picnic. We were not able to do that for various reasons over the course of the summer proper. But here we have this opportunity, and we're very thankful to God to even have it. So I just wanted to invite everyone here following our 10:45 service. We will have a picnic out back yonder. It really should be a good time just to gather one another and just to be in one another's presence with Jesus. So with that, I want to share our worship theme for this morning. A part of us expects justice from God. We think that fairness ought to reign, that each of us should get what we deserve. But this is a dead end. God does not give us what we deserve, but acts with mercy and grace beyond belief. He is scandalously generous and lavish with us, giving us what we do not deserve and have not earned. We are tempted to ask God for equity and what we deserve, but God is determined to give us so much more in Christ. Only in faith can we learn to let God be God, to honor his generosity with the only response he desires, faith and thanksgiving. Today, we pray the Lord to break through to our hearts and minds with his abundant grace and to rejoice that he is more than fair. He is merciful. And with that, we worship.
Thank you.
say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may abide in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
And Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace let us pray to the Lord. From above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
Lord,
Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord, Lord,
to your word, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our Old Testament lesson is from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 55, verses 6 to 9. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has the gospel without fear become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. For I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I will eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one Spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, and that you will be saved, and that by God, for it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the offering. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 and in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more, but each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you've made them equal to us who bore the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
always a wonderful sense when you get the sense that we're not just singing about Jesus, but we're singing to him. We say, Lord, you're Lord of all, and you can just sense his presence. I don't know about you, but just sensing his presence in the midst of our gathering as we sing to Jesus Christ, our Lord, is truly a gift and a privilege. So I hold here in my hands a fortune, a $10 bill, a fortune. You all don't seem impressed. But I tell you what, when I was a little kid in my neighborhood, if you had a $10 bill, you had a fortune. And often during the summer, we'd be able to make our money by cutting grass. You know, before we had large landscaping businesses like they are now, so prevalent, kids would go around the neighborhood with their lawnmower and their little canister of gas, and you could make a lot of money, $5 a lawn, maybe 10, you know, back in those days. And this $10 bill, let me tell you, when the ice cream truck rolls around, you remember those ice cream trucks? I mean, you could get like a twin pop, you know, 25 cents. You know how many you can get? I mean, you'd be rolling in dough. Mr. Softy, you guys have a Mr. Softy around here in Connecticut? You get soft serve ice cream from the truck? Oh, man. I mean, you get dollar sprinkles. I mean, it's just amazing. $10 went a long way, and you could make a lot. But you know what I remember is that I never, ever got one of these for mowing my own lawn. I just can't remember it. I strayed, I thought, I said, wait a minute, have I ever got one of these, a $10 bill, for mowing my own lawn? Did my father ever pay me? Well, as hard as I try to remember, I can't remember it. He would say, go mow the lawn, and I'd go mow the lawn. That's just how it was. Well, why might you think that my father didn't give me cash for doing the lawn? Well, why do you all think? Well, I hear it. You're grumbling out there. It's obvious. Well, he's your father. He told you to do it, right? I mean, when you think about it, I mean, what was the incalculable blessing of being in my father's house? You know, food and clothing and house and home and all of the things that we can't even calculate that our parents have given us over the course of our lives. It's just absolutely amazing. And dare I say, looking back, it was a privilege to be involved in the work of my father's house, just to be part of what he was doing to provide for our family, both he and my mother. And isn't that a picture of what Jesus is talking about in our gospel? It's not about my father owing me money for doing the lawn. It's sheer gift, it's sheer grace, it's sheer love, and what a privilege we have to be part of our father's enterprise of salvation in Jesus Christ. His love and his mercy for you and for me, which abundantly gives us all things beyond what we can ever imagine. And so we are the children of God by grace. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, may we not flee to any other, but may we continually come to the fountain of life and grace, Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord, and we thank you once more for this opportunity, and in your name do we pray. Amen. So grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning I want to share from the topic of labor, not in vain. Labor, not in vain. So it was often the case that many prophets, as they were given their divine assignment and task, would have moments where they would wonder, where they would struggle, what's the point of all of it? It doesn't seem like the people are listening. It doesn't seem like anything is happening. What's the point of my labor for the Lord? And Isaiah, who was the author of our Old Testament lesson, had a moment like that. And this was back in Isaiah 49. In verses 3 and 4, the Lord assures him. He says, "You are my servant Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But here's what the prophet said. "I have labored in vain, and I've spent my strength for nothing at all." And perhaps with a sigh, "Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God." You ever have moments like that in your life? You ever wonder, what is it all for? What's the struggle for? What's the toil for? What's the purpose in your life? Maybe you've had that moment when you were on your jobs, regardless of what they did, what your vocation is. You've had that moment where you just wonder, well, what's the point of my employment or my job beyond just, you know, making the money and all the other things? What exactly is the point? Well, I guess we could think in a pious way, but if we were walking with Jesus directly, you know, if we were in his company and in his presence, we wouldn't have such thoughts. We wouldn't think such things. Everything would just be wonderful and beautiful, but that wasn't the case. Don't you know the Apostle Peter? Peter had a moment like that. And this is actually the entree to our gospel lesson. In the chapter before, Matthew 19, Peter asked the Lord point blank in verse 27 of chapter 19. He says, "We have left everything to follow you. What then will there be for us?" Left everything for you, Jesus. I left my home. I left wife behind, because we understand Peter was married. He left his business, his livelihood, and here he is on the lonely road with Jesus. And sometimes it seems the people are listening, but more oftentimes Jesus is being rejected. What's it all for? What's the point? Peter wasn't immune to that either. You know, I mean, just like you, just the constant barrage of things that happen and that are happening in our culture and our society. Look, regardless of what political stripe you have, you know, we have lost a Supreme Court justice, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. It's a big blow for the nation. Anytime something like that happens, and, you know, it just seems that it's just yet another thing to place a burden on the fragility of our nation as it is. The people down in the Gulf Coast, you know, they just had a storm last week, right? And I don't know if you know, but they're forecasting another one coming that way. I mean, a lot of people are literally waterlogged and they're burdened. And I'm sure many of you, in your own different way, in your family, in your lives, as you consider the nation, maybe you begin to feel, well, Lord, what is it all for? And where is it all going? What place do I have in it? Maybe even as a church, we're wondering, well, what are we supposed to be doing in a time like this? What is our purpose? Well, the Lord reassures Peter. He says to Peter, "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or fields for my sake will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first." He assures Peter. He says, "Stick with me, man. I got you. I'm well aware of what it is that you have sacrificed, and I want you to know that because of your connection to me, you're already blessed. And you will receive 100 times in this life, more than you can understand, more than you can calculate, and eternal life in the time to come. But even when you hear that, when Peter hears that, is that enough for us often? Do we just say, okay, Jesus, well, now everything is fine again? Well, as you know, we kind of have peaks and we have valleys. We go down into the valley, then we have our peaks. And I believe this parable is for us. It's a message for us. Let's just say us in the valley. So, Jesus shares this parable, and I think it really is connected and an answer to Peter's question. He says, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers in his vineyard. And this is very key in verse 2. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and send them into his vineyard. So at the very beginning of the day, the beginning of the workday, he agreed with certain workers to work for a denarius in his vineyard. And the Lord's enterprise here is so large and so profound, we find him at 9 in the morning going out again. He goes out again, he finds others standing in the marketplace, perhaps standing on Main Street. I'm sure as you all have gone up and down Main Street, I'm sure you've seen that workers to this day sometimes stand in certain places so that they can be contracted and hired for work. And this is the same as it is here. 9 in the morning, he goes, he says, hey, how come you're standing here doing nothing? Go into my vineyard and work, and I will pay you whatever is right. Now, at this point, because a certain portion of the workday had already gone past, they couldn't expect a full day's wage, a denarius. So the landowner, the Lord, says, I'll pay you what's right. He went out again about noon, and he went out about 3, and he said the same thing. And he says, I'll pay you what is right. About 5 in the afternoon, in the old translations, it says the 11th hour, just to emphasize it. He goes out and he finds others standing around. He asks them, why have you been standing here all day doing nothing? And they said, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you also go and work in my vineyard, and I'll give you what is right. Of course, at the 11th hour, with only 1 hour left in the workday, you probably wouldn't be thinking that you're going to get a full day's wage. You just want what you can get. In fact, I would imagine that at the end of the day and no one's hired, you start to feel kind of desperate. You know, think about it from a worker's perspective. You know, you have a family to go home to. Another day, empty, nothing. But here, this landowner does something quite amazing. He hires them, sends them into the vineyard. And it says in verse 8, when evening came, the owner of the vineyard came and said to the foreman, call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired, going on to the first. Now's the time of accounting. This is payday. This is the moment. Now the last workers, the ones who were hired the 11th hour, 5 in the afternoon, came and each received a denarius, a day's wage. Isn't that amazing? Like, you shouldn't just like blow past that. That is absolutely amazing, beyond anything that these workers could have ever imagined. I mean, they were hired the last hour of the workday, and they received a full day's pay. I mean, I don't know if any of you ever worked in an office or whatever, and somebody just coming in at the last moment and getting the same amount as you. I think I see some embodied language out there. I don't know how fair that would be. Maybe we need to unionize against this guy. I don't know. He's not operating fairly. So when he came to those who were hired first, they expected to receive more. Wouldn't you? It's a very human thing. In fact, you're thinking, man, those guys got a full day's wage. What are we going to get? I mean, we've been here the whole day. Man, just imagine, you're probably thinking they're going to get some kind of bonus. But each one of them also received a denarius. What would you do before we judge them? What would you do? What would you be thinking? When they received it, they began to grumble. And in the Greek text, these are things that are happening in their thoughts. It's not clear that they verbalize the grumbling, but they're grumbling in their thoughts. You know, maybe truth be told, like when your father tells you to go cut the grass and you want to go out and play, you have certain thoughts. Yeah, you have I've certainly lost when my parents give me the chore. They began to grumble. And these who were hired last, this is what they were thinking. They said, and you have made them equal. You have made those equal who have been hired last to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day. In essence, what are they saying? But it's not fair. This is not a fair practice. I mean, we've been out all day in that Palestinian-Israel heat. And these get hired the last day, the last hour. And they get the same as us. What's up with that? Well, the landowner, knowing their thoughts, answered one of them and said, I am not being unfair with you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for denarius? And that's very key, right? You remember verse 2? At the beginning of the day, they entered into a labor contract. I don't know, probably enforceable to this day. I'll pay you a denarius. And they went out on the basis of that contract, and they worked that whole day, and they received a denarius. The landowner is telling them, based on what I agreed with you, I've given you that which I agreed, so I'm not unrighteous. Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Doesn't that even sound like a modern-day philanthropist? You know, like the really rich guys who say, I don't have the right to do it with my own money, what I want to do. Are you envious because I am generous? So again, the last will be first and the first will be last. Well, I don't think we can use this text to justify unfair labor practices or to empower employers just to do whatever it is that they want with their employees. But I think what Jesus is saying to us, I believe what he's saying to us is that he doesn't want to deal with us on the basis of debt and obligation. Think about it. Our entire economy, our entire global economy to this day is predicated on the fundamentals of interlocking agreements, which we call debt. One person owes one thing to somebody else who owes another thing to somebody else. And if you really get into the nuts and bolts of our Fed system and our finance system, you realize that it's just interlocking obligations. It's just based on debt. That's how the world works. You do X, I'll do Y. The quid pro quo. And God is saying, I don't want to deal with you on the basis of quid pro quo. I want you to recognize that this vineyard that I've invited you into is an invitation to my family. This is the family business. Just like I shared with you with my own father as he asked me to cut the grass and to do chores around the house, this was connected because I was part of his family. I am his son. And he's not operating with me on the basis of debt or wages. He's operating with me on the basis of love and grace and mercy. And so Jesus is doing here, in the enterprise of salvation, God's vineyard is not about debt and quid pro quo. Don't we realize in this world that makes us so weary that everywhere you go, you're in the Father's vineyard? Everywhere you go, everywhere your footsteps, you're in the Father's vineyard. Every time you go to the grocery store, every time you go to a Costco, every time you go to a gas station, every time you go to a restaurant, every time you go to your jobs and your work and your office, whatever it might be, you're in the Father's vineyard and you are doing his work. In fact, God has tasked you. God has given you a choice to live your life to the fullest, to complete and operate in your gift and your blessings and your very destiny of your life. Everywhere you go is sacred because you are in the Father's vineyard. And the Father is not about, well, if you do X, I'm going to do Y. He's saying, because you're in my vineyard, I've empowered you, I've gifted you, I've given you the Holy Spirit, and I've empowered you to work. Whether the first of the day or whether the last of the day, it's all based on gift. So we get discouraged sometimes. And maybe in the course of our lives, we're tempted to grumble. And we say, but Lord, I'm bearing the heat of the day. I'm bearing a burden that I cannot share with others, that perhaps no one else even knows in my life. I'm bearing a cross, and it's difficult, and I'm not quite sure how I can go on. Unless we just dismiss that out of hand, do you know what one of the great crises of our times is? Mental health. skyrocketing in the youth. Suicides. People are at breaking points. Churches are at a breaking point. And I think what Jesus is sharing with us in this passage is that the thing that is always critical in our work, it's not the rewards. It's not the stuff. How about this? It's just faithfulness to the task. Faithfulness that is born out of sheer gratitude. Faithfulness and obedience that is born out of sheer love because of what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. Think about it. They said, we have borne the burden of the work in the heat of the day. Isn't that what Jesus did for us? He bore the heat of our sin. He bore the burden of our iniquity. And he carried that all in the heat of the day to the cross. And there on that cross, he bore the burden for all of us by shedding his blood so that we might be part of the family of God, the family of his Father. And he didn't complain. He didn't grumble. He says to the Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? But does he come down from the cross? No, he doesn't come down from the cross. He stays right there, obedient to the task, obedient to his destiny, obedient to what the Father had called him to do for you and for me. So how about us? Eyes on Jesus. Eyes on the task. Your own task that only you can do, that only God has given you to do. You know, sometimes you go on visits and you meet with people and, you know, they might say, well, you know, I think I'm a little bit too old to be doing this thing or that thing. Or sometimes you talk to people and they say, well, I'm too young. What can I do? Each one of us has a task, and the fact that you're here on planet Earth right now is proof positive that God still has work for you to do. And with our eyes on Jesus in consideration for all that he has done for us in sheer gratitude, we say, I'm just going to be faithful to the task. I'm just going to love you. I'm just going to follow you no matter what. So I want to end with this verse. The Apostle Paul encourages us, and I want you to be encouraged. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't just throw it all away because you see society acting in certain ways. Paul says this, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, he's speaking to us, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Your labor, what you're going through right now, it is not in vain. The Lord knows all. He sees all. He's your Father. He loves you. You're in his house. You're in his service. Your labor is not in vain. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand with me as we confess the words of the Apostle. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please greet one another in the Lord's peace. Please stand with me for prayer. Let us pray for the whole Church of God and for each according to them. Lord, you have invited us to seek your face and to call upon you while you are near. Lord, grant to us such confidence in your grace and favor that we seek your wisdom, walk in your ways, and delight in your gift of salvation with thanksgiving in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We delight in dwelling in your house, O Lord.
we say and do. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You are our light and our salvation, and in you we rest our fears. Lord, grant your aid, comfort, and strength to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Be especially with the sick for whom we pray this day. We should pray on behalf of Joan Sherwood or Wally Watson, a friend who is in severe leg pain. Lord, we ask that Wally would be healed, that the source of the problem would be identified and dealt with. We pray that through the pain that he would see Jesus, and that he would be drawn closer to the Savior. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, so we do pray for our nation. We pray for the family of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. We pray for the considerable circle of friends and even for our nation at her loss. Lord, forgive us for immediately jumping into politics when we should stop and mourn the loss of a human life. So, Lord, please be with our nation. Be with those on the Gulf Coast who have dealt with a storm and who are going into a storm. Continue to be with those in California who are dealing with the raging wildfires. Continue to be with our cities that are dealing with unrest and violence. And Lord, protect your church and cause your church not to lose heart, not to give up, because Lord, our labor is not in vain in Christ Jesus our Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Your power is greater than all, and your mercy is without limit. Lord, look with compassion upon our world of violence and terror. Bless those who govern here and everywhere, that they protect the weak, promote the cause of virtue, administer justice to the criminal, and act with mercy toward those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have given us a place at your Son's table and grace to receive his very body and blood. Lord, grant that we come with repentance and faith to receive all that Christ has accomplished for our salvation in his blessed communion with the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, you have shown us generosity greater than we deserve. O Lord, silence our complaints when we would question your mercy, and teach us to be satisfied by your grace in all that we need for this mortal life, and find contentment in God's promise of the life to come. Teach us to rejoice over every sinner who repents, and for everyone who comes to you in faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these and whatsoever other things we need, we ask you to grant us in the name of Jesus our Lord. Into your hands, O gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
It is truly
right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming obedient unto death, even death upon a cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from the eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.